Reisen macht Spaß, egal wo du auch bist. Ich wollte euch das nur sagen, damit ihr das auch wisst. Lesen macht Spaß, Lesen ist der Hit. Ich bin das Lesen-Nass und kommt, macht alle mit.
Dear children, dear parents, today I'm going to introduce you to the stories of the Little Rhino Chatterbox. There are three books by Chatterbox. The picture language book, A Day with Chatterbox, is for children from 0 to 3 years. This book is available in 9 different languages. The multilingual book, A Year with Chatterbox, is for children aged 3 to 6 years. In this book, the stories of Chatterbox are told in 9 different languages. The reading book, Chatterbox Summer Holiday Diary, is for primary school children aged 6 to 10. This book is available in German and also as a turnaround book in 6 other languages. And this is what a turnaround book looks like. Half of the book is written in German, and when you turn the book over, the other half is written in another language, here in English. And now have fun with the Summer Holiday Diary of the Little Rhino Chatterbox. July 15th. Holidays at last. I spent half of the first day just dozing around. Then I got straight to being bored. Out of sheer excitement about everything I didn't have to do in the holidays, I'd given no thought whatsoever to what I wanted to do. Suddenly, Anna stood at the door, ringing the doorbell like mad, completely out of breath, thinking I was gone already. Gone? Where? To the pools, of course, like everyone else. Yeah, I could have thought of that one. So I rushed off to get my swimming stuff together. As we were just heading off, Mom stopped me, hoisting a lunchbox and a bottle of drink upon me. I actually had to go to the pools with my school stuff. Yeah, I know you get hungry after swimming, but you don't get a hankering for cheese sandwich and bell pepper slices. Thankfully, Ennis had been given some money, so we went into the shop first to buy a bag of crisps and a bottle of Coke. At the pools, it was really full. You could barely see the grass for all the towels. Just as we were about to give up looking for the others, we almost ended up tripping over Leo and Mo drying off in the sun. They poked fun at us for being so late. They got there early enough to be able to pick the best spot to lay down. Anyway, Ennis got changed right away and jumped right into the pool with a cannonball. Wish I pulled my trunks on at home. I find it really awkward doing this on the field, and the men's changing room is a right nightmare. I then stood there looking stupid for a while, watching Anna swim. Then I found Yaku and Luis. It looked like Yaku was teaching Luis to swim. Yaku was running back and forth in trunks and a t-shirt, giving Luis instructions like a real swimming teacher. All that was missing was a coach's whistle. Luis paddled through the water, spluttering along the way, looking like he was struggling. Once he saw me, I guess he'd had enough. Luis then had to go at me, not to look at him so funny. I couldn't resist having a dig at that point, about which I was actually sorry. Because in a way, it's really quite cool to admit that you don't know how to swim, and to learn how to. But when the lanky beanpool made a point of saying how fat floats to the top, so I shouldn't have any problem swimming, that's what did it for me. Then I really started taking the mick out of him. I pointed out that even my little sister was able to swim, and how he was a loser. That's where Yaku stepped in and told me to stop being so mean. Even Ennis, who had swum in towards us, gave me an evil look. Great, all against one. So, I decided to get out of there, disappearing into the toilet booth to get my trunks on. When I got back, Luis, Yaku and Ennis were on the blanket with Leo and Mo. I wanted to do a really cool jump into the pool with a running start until this old guy comes toward me and seriously says, "Oi, chubby." Yeah, he actually called me chubby. Don't you even think about jumping into the pool. You end up splashing all the water out. I do still want to go swimming, you know. Seriously? Had he completely lost it? I couldn't believe that an adult could be that mean. If my friends hadn't been there, I think I would have cried. But when it comes down to it, they are there for me. So they all jumped up and dove into the pool at the same time, which caused a right splash. Of course, he was absolutely soaked through and pretty mad. The boys just dove under and the old man had no one left to whinge at. I had a huge grin on my face and behind his back did a cannonball into the pool. Something that I'm best at for a change. The guys cheered and then we had a little diving competition. When we were laying on the blanket later, completely knackered, the pool was a bit emptier. So we were able to expand our campsite a little. So there we were, laying down, waiting for the sun to dry our trunks. I love laying on my back, just watching the big blue sky. When Ennis and I unpacked the Coke and crisp, we became heroes. The others only had their lunch boxes with them, but we even finished those up. Yup, swimming definitely makes you hungry. Later we met a few others from school, including some girls from our class. Samira, the girl who sits next to me, wasn't there, unfortunately. We all had a big water fight. It was really fun. Tomorrow we all want to meet up at the pool again. July 22nd. We went to the pool every day last week. As far as I was concerned, we could have kept doing that all through the holidays. But since the big thunderstorm yesterday evening, it's got a lot colder. Outside, it's all gray and overcast today, regardless of which window I look out of. All gray. Even everything in me is gray. Well, my skin is gray anyway. The sun didn't change anything there. Not like Ennis, Mo and Jakob, who got a hell of a tan. And Luis at least got sunburn. But me? No. I'm gray. Thankfully, Ennis called. No idea how long I'd been pushing down my horn on the living room window, blurting out, gray. He wanted to drag me over to the library. Library. Really hard words to pronounce. Ennis said I could just pronounce it library instead. Just because Ennis goes to the library, he didn't have to make himself out to be such a know-it-all. Anyway, Ennis wanted to borrow a book about guinea pigs, and his mom had books to take back. Ennis didn't even have any guinea pigs. He told me that he wanted some, but was only allowed to have them when he'd found out exactly what it means to own them. So now he knows what guinea pigs eat, how to treat them, and in particular, how not to. Being at the library can't be as bad as being gray. We met at the Brunnenstraße metro station and traveled to St. Reinhold Church. I'd already been there before. Last winter we went to the Christmas market with our class to take biscuits. It wasn't far to walk from the tram stop to the library. Of course, I'd already seen it from outside, but never really thought about what a weird building it is. Doesn't even look like a building. Not in the sense of a building with bricks and a roof in the way that my little sister would draw a house. It's made completely out of glass and looks more like a big bowl. So in we go, into the bowl, through the revolving door. What a sight! This library is huge. 3 floors with escalators and everything full of bookshelves. But it's not just booked. You've also got games, music CDs, audiobooks, DVDs, magazines, even console games. And I think there's even more. There are computers to use as well. They have a lot of computers there. And Jakub, who I was surprised to also meet there, told me that Luis, who takes trumpet lessons, even gets his music sheets there too sometimes. I didn't realize that all of my friends were bookworms. Ennis said you didn't have to be. Jakub is really into mangas. There are loads of them there, way more than in the school library. So I'm getting curious. This is where my mom would have been asking, what's the small print, by which she means, what's the catch? That's where Ennis and Jakub jumped in at the same time, and I found out that it's free for kids to borrow books, games, and so on if they have a library card. Only DVDs and console games cost a small fee. You can keep the things at home for a certain amount of time. You can even extend the loan, but if you bring them back late, break them, or lose them, that can get really expensive. Good thing I'm so careful with my stuff. So they went to the main counter with me and we asked about a sign-up form. I was told I needed to get my mom or dad to sign it and that I could also bring my mom or dad's ID card with me. Probably a better idea to bring all of my mom with me. I want her to see this, and my little sister too. I bet they'd love this. The lady at the counter told me that there were books here in over 100 languages. Maybe there's even one in mom's language there. We then all went through the library on our own, and I have to say I really liked it there. It smelled so nice, and even the peace and quiet was nice. Not the kind of psst, be quiet kind of peace and quiet, but rather a concentrated, focused quiet. And the comic section is awesome. and so many audiobooks, I was really sad that I didn't have a library card yet. When we were just on our way out the revolving door, Anna's mom bumped into two old friends of hers. They didn't live near us, so they really wanted to spend some time yapping. Anna's mom then offered to buy us a cup of tea and a pastry in a cafe over the way. There were these little sweet Turkish things. Baklava, they were called. I think. I know them from Anna's birthdays. Everyone got to pick out three types, and they were really nice. So the day was quite nice after all. And not quite so grey. Mom promised me that we'd all go to the library together at some point. Hee hee. She was a bit surprised at the difficult words that I knew. July 25th. When I get up early this morning, well, not that early, I realized right away there was nothing going on today. Nothing. Nada. Zero. Zilch. I'd like to have slept in some more, but I couldn't. So I just stared at the ceiling for a while, but there's nothing there to see except the lamp. That's where I noticed for the first time that I still have my children's lamp there, with a little polar bear on it. Crikey. I'm really too old for that now. I definitely need a new, cool lamp. So then I thought that it might be a good time for breakfast, and so I rolled out of bed. Mom wasn't there, just a note from her on the kitchen table. That's when I remembered that she had a dentist appointment and was going to meet a friend afterwards. Of course, she'd taken my little sister with her. In the note, she'd written everything that I was allowed to eat. Bread, cheese, yogurt, apple, bananas, and the rest of the potato salad. She even left a bag of crisps there for me. So I made a cheese sandwich and a cup of hot chocolate and ate a raspberry yogurt. Then I went back to the bed. But because I'd had enough of staring at the ceiling, I sat and pushed my pillow against my back. I thought about what I could do in bed except sleep, snooze, and stare at the ceiling. Sucks that I can't have a smartphone. I bet over half of my class has one. But my parents are relentless when it comes to that. Ennis is with his grandparents the entire week. If I had a phone, we could at least write. Ennis had a phone for almost a year now. Okay, so what about the new comics I bought a while ago using my own library card from the library? So the options are read, draw, listen to music, listen to audiobooks. Eating's out because crumbs are scratchy, especially from crisps. And if I make a mess on the bed, I not only get stick from my parents, it's disgusting anyway. I could watch TV in bed, but for that I'd need a TV in my bedroom, which I'm not allowed to have either. No phone, no TV. Just because my parents grew up in the Stone Age doesn't mean I have to. But alright, before I got totally depressed, I got out of bed and fetched everything I might need. Just don't make too much of an effort. If I was going to have a lazy day, then I was going to make it really lazy. So I put down some comics, the hilarious book that had Ennis in absolute stitches, my favorite CDs, the old audiobooks, a drawing book, and some pencils. Because I'd forgotten my eraser, I had to get up again. Bugger. And then I actually went and did all that. I was laughing my head off, listening to music, singing along loudly, listening to an audiobook, and drawing our aeroplanes, and eating a bit of potato salad now and again. I was really surprised when I suddenly heard the sounds of keys in the door and voices down the hallway. Mom, Dad, and my little sister all came in at the same time and were really in a good mood. Mom then made my absolute favorite food, pancakes with cheese and ketchup. I managed to eat six of them. And Dad said that there'd be a surprise film after for the whole family and we'd be watching it in our PJs. And whoever falls asleep gets carried to bed. Another day that was better than I thought it'd be, and the rain had finally stopped. August 5th. My nan and granddad have an allotment here in the north of Dortmund. My granddad is there almost every day, but I know he doesn't just work there. He also likes to lounge around there with a newspaper and a pipe. He sometimes likes to have an afternoon snooze on the old sofa in the allotment hut. My nan is always there when there's fruit and veg to be picked. Sometimes the whole family meets up there for a coffee or a barbecue, but this time I was asked to help. Mom said that the apples were ripe and needed to be used for something quickly, because they wouldn't keep. So Nan decided to make it an apple compote. Us kids were expected to go and collect and pick the apples. There was no getting away from it. There was no reasoning with Mom. I had to go. Sucks that my cousin Dina had to come with me. Dina's a year older than me and has been quite bitchy lately. Recently, she made a point of ignoring me and just played with my little sister. When we got to the allotment, my aunt and Dina had already been working for a while. Dina didn't make any comments. She just said hi, casually waved, and got back to her collecting. My aunt, on the other hand, "Hello, Chatterbox, sweetheart," she yelled out loud. "Is she nuts? I've been telling her for years not to call me that anymore." Nan had already set everything up outside. A tub to wash the apples, a stove with a big saucepan, a kettle and loads of buckets, kitchen knives and jam jars. The smell of apple compote was in the air, and I knew that we'd be getting some too, and that there'd soon be potato pancakes with apple compote. Dad will be thrilled. It's his absolute favorite food. So Dina and I collected apples more or less in complete silence, and my little sister went all out. She was darting back and forth, working really hard, but she was talking and laughing the entire time. It was a bit annoying, but I was grateful for it, because it meant I didn't have to say anything. Eventually, we finished collecting the apples from the floor and picking them from the tree. But of course, our apple compote cook still had plenty to do. Just in case, I'd packed my book in my backpack and looked for a quiet, shady spot in the side of the allotment hut. I thought if they didn't see me, they might leave me alone. I got comfy under a cherry tree. To my surprise, Dina had the same idea, sitting close with her back against the hut. "What you are reading?" she asked, more out of politeness than curiosity. I held up my book so that she could see the cover. She flashed a grin, almost just like she used to when we played together. Dug inside her bag and pulled out the same book, no less. Of course, I had to smile as well. She was only a few pages ahead of me. So we sat in peace for a while opposite one another until my little sister peeked around the corner. "Come on," she called. "Apple compote is ready, and we've got waffles. Nan's famous waffles." Of course, that got us running back to the others right away. Of course, they left us some waffles, and we all ate a huge mountain of waffles together. August 12th. Just yesterday, Ennis was telling me the holidays were boring. Something had to happen. Something unexpected. Something exciting. A bit of action. Well, now he's got his action. I bet now he wishes he was bored again, because then he'd still have his bike. They got broken into last night, not the flat. Ennis said that would have been even scarier, shuddering at the thought of a flashlight-wielding masked burglar sneaking into the flat at night with a bag over his shoulder while everyone slept peacefully. Thankfully, it was just the basement, but that was bad enough. When his mom went down to the basement this morning, she saw right away that the padlock had been broken. And not just our padlock, but every padlock to the rooms in the basement. Anna's mom then raised the alarm and rang on everybody's doorbells. The neighbors then went running down to the basement to see what was missing. Anna's bike, which was still pretty new, some top quality tools, a big suitcase and a sports bag. The burglar had even nicked some clothes from the washing line, from the laundry room and some food. "All my supplies," complained the neighbor, who lives down below and always pretends to be the building caretaker in charge of the place. Usually, she always hears about what's happening in the building and is always complaining about us. Only wish she'd paid better attention last night. Must have been a right racket in the basement. Loads of screaming and shouting. Then someone called the police, who arrived pretty quickly. Two cops came, a man and a lady. They looked at everything and made note of what was missing. After a while, Ennis asked when the evidence collection team would be there. One of the cops looked up quite surprised from her notes and praised Ennis for his excellent knowledge. Maybe he wanted to be a police officer too? Ennis has seriously been thinking about this since. So she had a quick word with her colleague and said, "All right, the evidence collection team will be along soon. But you usually don't find fingerprints on broken padlocks, because burglars mostly wear gloves. But maybe the guys will find a few fingerprints or at least an earprint. What? An earprint? Ennis wasn't the only one surprised. Even the adults were, even those who watch cop shows every evening. But then it dawned on me. Burglars listened first to see if someone might be in the basement. But before evidence collection came, the policewoman asked if Ennis' bike was registered. Reggie, what? His mom understood, though, and said yes right away. She ran into the flat and fetched a piece of paper with the number of the bike on it. The officers wrote it down and said that there was a chance that the bike might be found, and possibly even the thief. Then the evidence collection team actually came, two men this time. They had a big black case with brushes and black powder that they used to search for fingerprints and earprints on the big door to the basement area and the other doors. When they found something, it was marked with tape. We can't tell if it's usable yet, said one of the team, who Ennis had been watching the entire time and who was friendly enough to answer Ennis' questions. It was really exciting. At the end, one of them said, if we find anything here that leads us to the perpetrator, the victims will receive a message from the police. Ennis had real trouble repeating the sentence exactly and needed a few tries. I'll have to remember that, he said, if I actually want to be in the police. He then came straight to me, told me everything, and said we could take matters into our own hands and look for his bike. Maybe someone here nearby was cheeky enough to be running around with it in the neighborhood. Though that's what we did. We looked around on the road, in backyards, and everywhere, and at one point we saw a parked bike that looked very similar to Ennis' bike. He was really excited, but it turned out not to be his. We searched for a long time, but eventually we had to get home. Ennis was very sad about it, but I promised that we'd carry on looking tomorrow, and that our other mates would probably also help. Ennis just nodded, gulped, and mumbled, bye. Honestly, I don't think he'll be getting his bike back, and I'm really mad that someone could be so mean as to steal other people's stuff. Am 15th of August. We, I mean Ennis, me and the other guys, went searching for Ennis' bike for a few days, but we didn't find anything and neither did the police. But right now, not forever, but at the moment at least, Ennis doesn't need a bike. He's now got a cat. A little cat. He went to the animal shelter's open day with his mom. Actually, they only went to have a look. Ennis actually wanted a guinea pig. But then Ennis saw that cat. You won't believe how cute she is, he said, squeaking the word cute in a way that only girls otherwise do. And he told me about how cheerfully it played with the ball on a string while it was in its little cage. Ennis was lucky that his mom was just as charmed by the cat, and after a phone call with his dad, who gruntingly approved, they actually did it. They borrowed a travel basket and went home with the little cat. If you want to see her, you'll have to come over, Ennis said on the phone. So I went right over. After all, I like cats, animals in general, but especially cats. They don't stink like guinea pigs and they even like to cuddle. It's usually always Ennis that opens the door when I ring the doorbell. I ring in code, long, long, short, so that Ennis knows it's me. He does the same with me. But this time, Ennis' big sister opened the door. She had a grin on her face. Ennis can't come to the door right now. He can't move an inch. I completely got the wrong end of the stick and thought of my Nan, who couldn't move an inch whenever she had back problems. But Ennis didn't need his back seeing to. He needed his head seeing to. But I could understand why a little. He was sat stiffly on the sofa, the little gray striped cat on his lap. She had her eyes closed, and Ennis was stroking him very gently. Have a seat, whispered Ennis, but carefully, then have a listen. So I put my ear next to the cat and listened to it purring. Ennis flashed a satisfied smile. She's called Ninja, he explained, because she's such a fearless fighter. Not exactly my idea of what a fearless fighter should look like. After a while, she opened up her eyes, green eyes, and yawned. And that was a heck of a yawn. I could see her rough, pink tongue. Then she jumped off of Ennis' lap and looked around for something to play with. There was stuff everywhere for her to do, enough for 10 cats. Ennis had looked for everything in the house that he thought a cat could play with. Little balls, corks, a ball of wool. and he even bought Little Toy Mouse with his pocket money. It already looked as though it had been put through the wringer. There was also a nice soft basket in a bowl with water. Of course, we got off the sofa as well and played with Ninja. She had in it for our toes in particular, which is how I noticed that she was actually a fighter. But eventually, she said enough of playing and fighting, slurped on some water, and then cleaned herself. Ennis could barely contain himself, but she really did look incredibly cute, the way she ran over her nose with her paws and how she contorted her body to be able to lick everywhere. Then, I guess she'd had enough, but she didn't go into her nice basket. She just disappeared, went into hiding. Okay, that's enough, said Ennis' mom. Leave her be. You can go and do something else now. Okay. So we went off to see Yaku. August 24th. Back to school on Wednesday. Somehow the holidays have gone by really quickly. I always used to really look forward to going back to school, especially to see all my friends again. Malek, for example, spends the entire summer holidays with his grandparents in Turkey each year. It's not worth going otherwise as the trip is so long. This year, Luis, Mo and Yaku had been gone for a few weeks, but they're finally back again. I met them at Hakim's birthday today. Hakim is in my class. I don't actually know him that well. He only came into my class after the Easter holidays. He started out pretty shy, but now he's our class clown. He does pretty funny things, tells jokes, puts funny faces and so on. Sometimes he gets into trouble for it, but sometimes he even gets a laugh out of the teacher. I didn't know at first if I should go, but it seemed he invited the entire class. And I wanted to see who had already come back from holiday. I was hoping that Samira would be there. I hadn't seen her all through the holidays. Hakim didn't invite us to his house, but to the Friedenbaum Park with a big teepee. Anne's mom brought us there. She didn't want to us taking the tram on our own. She always looked so serious, but when she saw that half of Hakim's family was there, including the adults, she just asked when we wanted her to pick us up again. Hakim's mom didn't let her leave, though. She didn't say anything. She just smiled, because Hakim's mom doesn't speak German very well, but she talks a lot in Arabic, and she rolls her eyes whenever Hakim acts like a joker. At the Friedenbaum Park, near the little teepee tents, there's also a wooden hut with a patio, a big table and wooden benches. We had the patio all to ourselves. We were all squeezed up on the benches and the table was on the verge of collapse under the weight of all the tasty food. Of course, the table wasn't actually at risk of collapsing, I just meant it figuratively, because the table was full of food. That's how it was. We all ate and ate and ate, but there never seemed to be any less of it. Hakim's mom, our older sister, kept putting new things on the table. I didn't know some of the stuff and was a bit cautious when tasting it, but most of it was so nice, that I had to have more of it. Eventually, though, we were really full up, absolutely stuffed. It was really hard to get up off the bench again. Then someone had the idea of playing hide and catch. I'm pretty bad at catching, but I can hide really well. We had the most fun with balancing, though. Hakim pretended he was in a circus and fell off the rope on purpose. All of us then did the same, trying to outdo each other until Arek hurt himself. We actually wanted to cool off in the smaller tipi tents, but nah, it was dark in there, but it was also even hotter than outside. It was a bit of a dare game to see who lasted longest in the tent. Eventually, though, we had to run out and get some air. And then it was almost nice to be outside. Didn't feel quite as hot. We avoided the barbecue spot where they were grilling corn on the cob. Usually I love that stuff, but first it was too hot. And second, I was too full, or the other way around. We didn't even get around to joining in the hut building or riding BMX bikes. The day absolutely flew by. Eventually, though, all the excitement had worn us out and we just wanted to rest on the patio and drink something cold. The table was full of tasty food again, stuff that people had brought with him, in loads of fridge bags. At first we groaned. We wouldn't be able to eat a thing ever again, but then did eventually try a bit. Suddenly, Anna's mom screamed out loud. Arik's trousers were covered in blood. All of the adults were panicking and shrieking, but Hakim's big sister kept calm. Hakim proudly told us that she was training to be a medic or something, with ambulance and sirens and all that. She carefully cut Eric's trousers open, then we saw Eric's wound. At the first sight of it, we all screamed. It looked like his entire leg has been torn to shreds, but it was just all the blood. Hakim's sister then dabbed the leg carefully with a wet cloth. Unbelievable, all the stuff she had in her bag. It was actually only his knee that had been injured, but the wound was so big that Hakim's sister thought it better to take him straight to a real doctor. The accident clinic was right by the park. Eric's leg was probably bandaged up before Hakim's dad carried him away on his shoulders. Hakim's sister went with them. Hakim was a wreck, worried that no one of us wanted to be friends with him anymore. Seriously? It wasn't Hakim's fault. All of us told him that his birthday was really nice, and that we were really happy to have him in our class. Now I'm actually looking forward to getting back to school a bit. I finally get to see Samira again.
Lesen macht Spaß, egal wo du auch bist. Ich wollte euch das nur sagen, damit ihr das auch wisst. Lesen macht Spaß, Lesen ist der Hit. Ich bin das Lesen-Nason, kommt, macht alle mit.